feet. You'll have every failure, God. You'll have every victory. When the best of me is barely breathing, when I'm not somebody I believe in, hold on to me. When I miss the light, the night is stolen. When I'm slamming all the doors you've opened, hold on to me. Hold on to me. Hold on to me when it's too dark to see you. When I am sure I have reached the end. Hold on to me. When I let go, hold me again. When I don't feel like I'm worth defending, when I'm tired of my pretending, hold on to me. When I start to break in desperation, underneath the weight of expectation, hold on to me. Hold on to me. Hold on to me when it's too dark to see you. When I thank you.
every day this never-ending pressure tries to take its claim over my heart. I have tried to hold it all together, but time and time again I fall apart. But that's where I find my life was never mine at all. But you are the one inside, always in control. So when it feels like all of this pain is never treasure. With eyes wide open now I finally see. It's here that I find my life was never mine at all. You're still the one inside, always in control. So when it feels like all of this pain is never strong enough. Only you can take this out of my hands, out of my hands. You're greater than all my sorrows, worthy of all my trust. Thank you, Lord, that this is out of my hands, out of my hands. So when it feels like all of this pain is never gonna end.
Welcome home. Wow, that's so glad you're all here. Today is such a special day, such a special day. If you're a guest with us, please take a card and fill that out. And this is the first time in 15 Thanksgivings, that Sherry and I have actually been here for Thanksgiving. We've never been here for Thanksgiving before. We always see my parents, and this year, with so much going on, we couldn't do that. So a year ago, in fact, I always book a year out for 11 Thanksgivings. This is the 11th Thanksgiving. I have always had Dr. Jim Henry with us for the week prior to Thanksgiving, actually. This year we flipped it, and I thought I might go home, and I did that some time ago. And so he is with us today, and for the first time in all these years, I get to hear him preach. So I'm very thankful for that. I need to make mention of just a couple things. You have an insert in your bulletin. Very few things that you give to does 100% go where you want it. If you give to United Way, or if you give to, there's just a Salvation Army or whatever, a lot of it's eaten up with administrative cost. This is Missions Dignity. It's a one-day offering. It is for pastors and pastors' wives who serve the Lord and have no retirement. 60% of the people who get this, one of them has died. As long as both had Social Security, they could make it. But when one person dies, and if you only have Social Security, y'all know then, it's a choice between medicine and groceries, and or medicine and utilities. Missions Dignity, everything we give, 100% of it goes to the person who served the Lord many times for 30, 40, and 50 years. and it's used to supplement their income at $200 a month. This year, there is either a corporate or individual donor that is matching all gifts. So if we give $5,000 today for widows, widowers primarily, if we give $5,000, it's doubled to $10,000. So I want us to try to meet that goal today. Sherry and I are giving, and I hope that you will give. This insert will tell you more about it, and you can even look it up online. And so I encourage you to give generously for that, and it's going to be a blessing that we can pass on. True religion is to take care of widows and orphans. That's what James says. And if you look at this, it tells you 60% are not only widows, but one in every four are 85 and older. So that's who we're helping to take care of. So that's really, really a valuable ministry. Our Christmas Spectacular. Today you're going to get a foretaste of that just a little bit. But it's on Saturday, December the 11th at 7 p.m. We will have a choir of 70, an orchestra of 22. You will not want to miss it. And that's on Saturday the 11th at 7, and then Sunday the 12th at 6. The reason 6 is because the kids still have school that next week, and they have exam week. So it's a little earlier so they can go home earlier on that Sunday night. We also have the kids' Jingle Jam Light Show, and that's open also for parents or grandparents at 6:30 p.m. right here in our sanctuary on the Friday, December 17th. And then you can see about the Christmas Eve services coming up. Well, church, I just hope that you are ready for a great day of worship where we worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. I'm so glad to see you all here. It's been a good week. I hope for you it's been a good Thanksgiving week, as every day is Thanksgiving, every single day. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord Jesus, we thank you for all your many blessings to us, for all the encouragement that you give us. Fill us with your Holy Spirit, Lord, and help us in every way to worship you in spirit and in truth. Give us eyes to see and ears to hear what your Spirit is saying to us, even in this hour. So bless us now, Lord, and encourage our hearts, and may we be built up in hope, faith, and love, the greatest of these being love. We ask all these things in the name that is above all others, the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen and amen.
Well, this past Friday night, I took my family down to the UCF football game, and it was amazing. I saw our very own Dave Allman and his wife Charity a few rows in front of me, and we had a blast. I had never been there before, but they call it the Bounce House. And let me tell you, those people were excited about football. It was the big rivalry weekend. They played USF, you know. But what I was thinking is, what if we got excited about Jesus this morning? What if we got excited about worship? You know what I'm going to do to get excited? I'm going to enter into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. I'm going to be thankful unto him and bless his name. You know why? Because he has made me glad. God can do anything. There's nothing that our God can't do. He can make this guy right here glad in the middle of the storm. Will you let him make you glad this morning? Will you enter into his gates? Let's stand as the church family, and let's declare good things about our God this morning. Let's say, there's nothing that our God can't do. One word, you call the storm that surrounds me. Just one word, the darkness has to retreat. Just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. Just one touch, my eyes.
Success.
know, church family, that when we come to the Lord Jesus and we surrender, we see the gift of eternal life that he's given us through his death and sacrifice on the cross, the resurrection. We see that and we grab a hold of it. We repent and we turn to God. Right in that moment, as this song just sang, we become a child of God. We're adopted into his family. We're part of his royal kingdom. Isn't that amazing? And once that happens, once we surrender to him, there's nothing that can take that away. We are his. Amen? We can have an assurance that the Lord Jesus is our King. And that God the Father is, in fact, our Heavenly Father. A blessed assurance. Blessed meaning happy, joyful, wonderful, amazing. Can we just sing that old song together, Blessed Assurance? Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine, heir of salvation, purchase of Of all the gifts and toys we knew we'd find, but we never realized a baby born one blessed night gave us the greatest gift of our lives. We were the reason that he gave his life. We were the reason that he suffered and died. To a world that was lost, he gave all he could give to show us the reason to live.
Jesus, you are the reason For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Lord Jesus, thank you because you give us hope. You are the reason, Lord, that we can have hope and eternal life, for there is no other name given among men whereby we must be saved. Oh, Lord Jesus, thank you for being the reason, not just for this season, but the reason, Father, for life, for freedom, for hope, freedom from sin, and Lord, to be able to live a life of purpose and of forgiveness. And Lord Jesus, we just thank you for loving us in spite of ourselves, in spite of ourselves, forgiving yourself on the old rugged cross that we might be saved. Thank you, Lord Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. You may be seated. Well, I think you've noticed already this room is completely decorated. And this is pretty amazing. Y'all need to know this. There weren't but three adults that did this. Actually, three adults and about 15 young people. So the youth and college students came up, and I know my kids were here literally from like, I believe, 9 or 10 in the morning until 4 yesterday evening. So this is hours and hours of all these young people working. And special thanks to Lauren and Matt Smith. I don't think they're in the room. I think they're over in the youth department. Lauren and Matt are the reason all this is decorated. Lauren has bought new, what do you call that green stuff? Thank you. New garland and all that kind of stuff. And so if you see Lauren Smith, give her a pat on the back and just let her know thank you for doing it. I purposely stayed away because I wanted to be surprised this morning. So I didn't know that they were putting the trees into a new place until I came in. And I thought, wow, that's different, but I like it. Different is good. It's good to have something different. So here's a list of all these kids. You need to just brag on them and tell them that you appreciate them. So Matt and Lauren and Mr. White and Bethany White, Nehemiah Parker and Naomi Parker, and then the Carter kids, all the Carter kids, April and Bree and Brandon, and then Bryce Bidding, I'm sorry, I'm struggling to get that. It's hard to say all those B's for me together. Bryce and Maddie Crane, Abby Brewer, and then Nate and Rachel, who are Scott and Debbie's two that are here, and then Ellie and Ethan. And since Evan has, it's not a broke finger, but it might as well be broke, we told him he couldn't come and help. He would have driven him crazy, although he was the one who wanted to come and help. That's the youngest. So, today, you are so blessed. One of my mentors, he's been one of my mentors for a long time. I knew him from afar until 2011. I had actually watched him many, many years ago. I'm a graduate also with one of my degrees from his alma mater, which is New Orleans Baptist Theological Seminary. He still teaches adjunctly there every year. He teaches at the Cove for my old boss there in it's not in Asheville, but it's not far from there. And so I'm just so grateful. Today is an anniversary for Jim Henry. 60 years ago this Sunday, he was ordained to the gospel ministry. So for 60 years, he has been proclaiming Jesus Christ is Lord. What an incredible, incredible legacy. Incredible legacy. As many of you know, he pastored down at First Orlando for over 29 years, and he's the author of 9 books. He has had 10 interims, so he transitioned in ministry after leaving First Orlando and has literally pastored churches all over in those 10 interims, and we are so grateful. Both his children and grandchildren are all serving the Lord, and we are so thankful to have him and his beautiful, lovely wife here today. And so would you give Jim Henry a wonderful round of applause? Thank you, brother. So appreciate it.
And thank you, Pastor, for the joy of being back at First Baptist Mountain Door. I feel like at home. I've been coming here so long. I just might as well move my letter and join and be a part of the family. 11 years. That's hard to believe that. And I tell you what, I'm all over the place preaching and being in churches. You got one of the premier pastor, leader, preachers in the whole country right there. And I don't say that because he invites me here. I say that out of reality. I know pastors, and you got a great one. And Aaron, did he leave? Okay. Aaron, come back. I want you to hear this sermon again. What a talent he is. Man, what a talent. And the choir, the music, it was just wonderful. Thank you, orchestra and choir. It's just going to be something else. I know Christmas is going to be exciting. So Kathy and I are glad to be here today to share this time with you all. And Pastor, thank you for the invitation to come back to Mount Dora. And I see some folks I've pastored in Orlando, and people I've met in different places. And it's always just good to come back and be here. And, I got married again for my second time. First wife passed away, and Kathy's here with me today. And, you know, I didn't realize, of course, when you get married the second time, you've got to learn each other. So you think you know each other, but you don't know each other like you thought you knew each other. You know what I'm talking about? So I find out that anniversaries are very special thing, different kind. I thought it's 1 year, two. No, it's 6 month anniversary. The night you proposed, those are anniversaries. And I thought, well, man, this is a whole new world for me. So I just recently I proposed to her in November. So she said, "Where are we going to celebrate?" I said, "What?" She said, "When you proposed to him." I said, "We're supposed to celebrate a proposal?" She said, "Of course." I said, "Well, okay, I'm learning this stuff." So I said, "What do you want?" She said, "I want you to take me out to a nice place where we can sit down and they bring the food out and you can look at what you want and look at the menu and they fix it right there in front of you. I really want to go to a nice place." I said, "Okay, I'll do that." So we went to Subway and that didn't work. But you know what I mean. Anyway, we're making the adjustments and moving along pretty well in life. And so I'm glad that she's joined me here today with Cams, whom we've known and loved through the years. And let's look forward to looking in the Word of God. If you got your Bibles with you, the book of Hebrews, chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12. And I always like to stand in honor of the Word of God. So if you'll stand with me as we honor the Word of God. Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. After I read the scripture, we'll have prayer, and then you can be seated. "Therefore, since we're surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. Let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that you will not grow weary and lose heart." May God add his blessing to his word. Would you pray with me? Father, thank you so much for the word. Thank you for the joy of celebrating Thanksgiving and every day and Christmas every day. We thank you for this season. And Lord, today we want to consider you and look at you afresh and anew. So speak to our hearts about who you are, because you've chosen us who we are in you. Let the words of my mouth, the meditation of my heart, be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. And you get great glory alone in your church through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, now and throughout all generations. And Holy Spirit, you speak through me. And let the word find fruit that remains in our lives. And your will be done in us and in this hour for those who need to make decisions and commitments to follow you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Be seated. In high school, there used to be a school down the road from us called East High School, and I ran for track for another school, Isaac Litton. At East High School, I went down there. I remember going for the track meet. They had, I think, six lanes to run in. And on the sixth lane, the outside lane, in the first turn, for some reason, they had a fence. I don't know if it was going out to the football field or at the locker room or something, but they had a fence that came up right to the edge of the outside lane. And so it was about this high, and it was a nice chain link fence. And I remember on this particular day, I had run, and I was watching relay teams run. And I remember a relay team, the guys in the outside lane, he took the baton, and he started running. He was looking to his back to get the baton. You're supposed to just put your hand there, but he looked, and he got the baton. But about the time he turned around, he drifted too far out to the right side, and boing, he centered that post. I mean, he went one way, the baton went the other way, the race was over for their team. And as I was thinking about this message, I thought, that's kind of the way life is sometimes. We get things out of focus, we end up getting hurt by looking at the wrong thing. The writer of Hebrews, we don't know who he was. Some say it was Barnabas, some say it was Luke, some say it was Apollos. Some people, they don't know. There's all kind of conjecture who wrote it. But whoever wrote it was a brilliant person. Greek scholars say that this is the most articulate, best use of the Greek language of all the writers of the New Testament. There's 5,000 or nearly 5,000 words of Greek, and this particular writer used over 1,000 of them in the book of Hebrews. In this book, he talks about Jesus quite a bit, because the people are living in a difficult time. Persecution is looming on the horizon. In not too many years, Nero is going to begin to persecute Christians. Paul and Peter are going to be executed. And so it's looming. They can see it coming. And some of the Christians there were losing heart. And so this letter's gone out to encourage them in a very difficult time so that they don't grow weary and lose heart in continuing. So how do you do that? Looking to Jesus. We're living in a time like that in this country and in the world. People are confused. People are losing heart. What's going on? We see inflation. We see gas prices soaring. We see trouble all over the world. We see things happening in our own country that we can't get a grip on. About one time you get something done about the virus, the thing pops up somewhere else. It's another variant coming on. We get rid of one and something else comes up over here. You know, I've been jabbed. I don't know about you. I've been jabbed, but I'm getting a little concerned about these jabbings. I don't know about you, but, you know, I think they ought to call it something beside the vaccine. A vaccine's supposed to keep you from getting some, but it looks like some people have had to keep getting it. I don't know about that. I've thought about that a whole lot. Maybe they ought to call it a therapeutic. I've been vaccinated for polio, and I didn't have to get another one. I've been vaccinated for smallpox, and I didn't have to get another one. Oh, how many times are we going to have to get jabbed? I don't know, but that's the kind of world we're living in. And, you know, we're living in a time where, you know, you don't know who to trust anymore. You know, you used to trust the FBI. I have some good people at the FBI, but I feel a little nervous about them. Department of Justice, I feel a little bit nervous about the Department of Justice. I'm a little bit nervous about some governors and mayors and presidents and this woke, you know, we got woke military and woke this and woke that and woke that and woke that. It just, you know, I kind of get the thing kind of like Senator Kennedy said, when I look around what's happening. Senator Kennedy from Louisiana said, our nation was founded by geniuses, but it's being run by morons. And sometimes I kind of feel like that's what's going on. It's just a crazy time to be alive. So how do we keep our balance? How do we keep on focused on what's important? Persecution, it says, looming for the church in that day. Persecution around the world. More Christians are martyred today than any time in history. Persecutions in the United States. laws that are being written, things that are being said, things are being done to cut off the church, cut off communication on some of the social media, so that if Christians say this about that, they cut you off. We're living in a crazy time. So how do we keep on fixed so that we do not lose heart? Look to Jesus. That's what the writer of Hebrews said. Consider him. So when we consider Jesus, let's look at his superiority. The writer of Hebrews, in the beginning of Hebrews, in the first chapter, he talks about the superiority of Jesus. He's greater than the angels. He's greater than Moses. He's greater than any person, anything. He's greater. He's so great that he created the universe and he holds all things together. That's who Jesus is. Jesus is superior to everything and every person. Who is Jesus? Some people said he was a revolutionary. Some people said he's a liar. Some people think he's a lunatic. Some people said he's a good man. Some people said he's a white man's God. Some people said he's a black man's God. Some people said he was a hippie. Some say he's an environmentalist. We get all kinds of, but who is Jesus? The writer of Hebrews said, look at his superiority. Look at what other people said about Jesus. The Pharisees said he eats with sinners and tax collectors. Pilate said, I find no fault in him. Paul said that the name of Jesus, every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. Peter said, this same Jesus whom you crucified is both Lord and Christ. The angel said, to you is born this day in the city of David a Savior. The centurion, as Jesus was being crucified, said, truly, he was a righteous man. The demon said, he's a son of God. John the Baptist said, behold the Lamb of God. Judas said, I betrayed innocent blood. John, the beloved disciple, said, he is the bright and morning star. Thomas said, my Lord and my God. Look at the superiority of Jesus. He's unique. He was man. The Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And he was God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. I like what Manuel Scott said. He was a wonderful black pastor. He's already with the Lord, but I used to, when he was going to preach, I wanted to hear him preach. And I didn't ever want to be on a program where I preached after him. In fact, when I'm invited to preach at different places, I said, don't put me after a black pastor. I said, I can't preach like black pastors can. They're great. Put me in front, I'll try to get on base. But don't put me after a black pastor, because once you've heard a good black pastor preach, I mean, you've heard the best. I love to hear my black pastor brothers preach. Manuel Scott was one of them. And he said this about Jesus. He said, the supernatural was naturalized. The ultimate was entangled with the immediate. The God up there became the God down here. The celestial became terrestrial. What a superior God he is. Look at his uncommon offices. He's called prophet, priest, preacher, teacher, king. Look at who he is, this undeniable character of Jesus. He was pure in all of his ways. He was righteous in all his ways. He never told a lie, never did anything wrong. His character was impeccable, is Jesus. Look at his unprecedented mission. Why did Jesus come? We're celebrating that at Christmas. What's Christmas about? God sent his son to do what? Just to come look around for a while and see what was going on? No. He had a mission. He came here to die. Most people come to live. Jesus came on a mission to become our substitute, to take our sins, to take our place. He had a mission to redeem us and adopt us as sons and daughters. Not only that, but when he died and was crucified, rose on the third day, ascended into heaven, what's he doing now? The Bible says he has an unceasing ministry. He is ever living to pray for us. Have you ever thought about Jesus praying for you? The Bible says that. Sometimes we ask somebody, pastor, would you pray for us? Or deacon, would you pray for us? Or brother or sister, would you pray for me? That's a wonderful ministry, to pray for each other. But just know that Jesus is praying for you. It boggles my mind to say, there's billions of people. How does Jesus know everyone? I don't know. I know that he does. And so he knows our every thought, our every prayer. Jesus is praying for us. He has an unceasing ministry. And notice what else he's doing. He is superior in the salvation that he brings. The Bible teaches us there's no other name among men given under heaven by whom we must be saved. Nobody else can save us. Only one person is a Savior, and his name is Jesus. We can try religions, we can try philosophers, we can try great thoughts of great people, we can try our own way, but we can't be saved except by Jesus Christ. There's no other name given under heaven by whereby we must be saved. The writer of Hebrews said, after he finished his work on the cross, he sat down in heaven. Now, when the Bible has words, they not words just thrown in there just to fill up the space. Every word has a sense of meaning, usually. And so when it says he sat down, I said, why does it say he sat down? Because this writer of Hebrews is writing particularly to Jewish Christians. The priest, and this has been the way for thousands of years, the high priest would go into the Holy of Holies once a year, take the blood of a lamb that had been sacrificed, go into that holy place and sprinkle that blood for the sins of the people for a year. That was their way of doing it. But when he walked in there, he couldn't sit down in there. He had to stand up. He had to stand up the whole time he was in there. And that's why when he went in, they had little bells on the tassel of his shawl. So when he walked in, you could hear these bells. He's walking around, ministering, sprinkling the blood, and they can hear the bells. If they stopped, they knew something had happened. He either fainted or he had a heart attack or something. When he stopped, they couldn't go in and get him. They had to pull him out, because only the high priest could go in. Now it says when Jesus became our high priest, he went to the Holy of Holies. He shed his blood. He became the lamb slain from the foundation of the world. And when he got through with his work on the cross, he said, finished. Didn't say, I'm finished. He said, finished. What finished? What the priest had been trying to show to the people for thousands of years, Jesus said, I'm it. I took your place. I can sit down now. So when he ascended into heaven, he sat down because the work was over. No more did the priest have to go in there and do that anymore. The work was finished. They couldn't offer him. Jesus, the Lamb of God. So how can you top Jesus? So when he ascended into heaven, he sat down. Job done. Mission accomplished. Work completed. He sat down. What a beautiful thing. You know, very interesting that in the book of Acts, when Stephen, the first one to shed his blood on the cross, or not on the cross, but to shed his blood for the cause of Christ, when he looked up into heaven as he's being stoned to death outside the walls of Jerusalem, he looked up and Jesus stood up. I mean, he was sitting down. Figuratively, he was sitting down. But he saw this faithful man standing up. And Jesus stood up to receive him to heaven. When you go to heaven, who's going to take us to heaven? Angels? Jesus? I'm not sure which one. Maybe both. A good friend of mine just recently, Jack Pogue, is a businessman in Dallas. They had an occasion for him a few weeks ago in which they honored him. He was a good friend of Dr. W.A. Criswell, who'd been pastor at First Baptist Dallas for over 50 years. And he had led Jack Pogue, a businessman, to faith in Christ. He baptized him in the Jordan River in Israel back in the early 70s. He and Jack became close friends through the years, and Jack supported his ministry and his work in many different ways. And toward the end of his life, Dr. Criswell got where he couldn't move around. His wife not taking care of him ably. Jack said, bring Dr. Criswell to my house. And so they brought Dr. Criswell to his old friend Jack Pogue's home. Jack Pogue put a bed in the same room with Dr. Criswell. He waited on him just like a servant. He cleaned up because he was couldn't control his natural functions. This godly, wealthy businessman took after him, fed him, cleaned up after him, sat in his room, slept beside him at night, helped him get up, down, changed his bed. He did all that because he loved Dr. Criswell. He told me and Kathy, he said, you know, Dr. Criswell told me two things. He said, Jack, he said, when I die, be sure in the casket, they put my Bible on my chest with my finger pointing to Isaiah 40 where it says, the word of God will not perish. It's forever and ever. And he said, I've preached the word of God, and I want my finger to be pointing to that scripture about the word of God endures forever. He said, the second thing, he said, you can't do anything about it, but he said, I've asked Jesus. He said, Jesus, when I die, I want you to come take me to heaven. He said, I've just asked him. I don't know if he will or not, but I've asked Jesus to, I want him to come and say, come on home. Jack said, Jim, he said, 3 days before he died, he fell unconscious. He didn't say anything. He didn't move. He was immobile. He just lay there, just barely alive. He said, the last night, I had my hand on his hand. He hadn't moved or said anything. He said, all of a sudden, he said, straight up, smile on his face, looking up. And he said, he just was frozen like that for a moment. Then he said, he lay back down. And he said, shortly thereafter, he was gone. He said, Jim, you know what I think happened? I think Jesus came, and his request was met, and he saw Jesus, who took him to heaven. Jesus, who'd been sitting down, stood up to bring his servant, W.A. Criswell, home. He sat down. What a great Savior we have. He could save us, finish his work, and all we can do is trust what he did. Some people, it's so hard, they stumble over it and say, well, it's too simple. It is simple. That's why even a child can understand. He died, paid for our sins, rose again. Trust him. Just that simple. All of our sins, because nobody can get into heaven that's a sinner unless he's forgiven and the blood covers him, the blood of Jesus. I was taking a group of young people to Panama City for a youth retreat. And about after 2 days, I got, you know, young people are wonderful, but it was, I needed a little white space. You know what I'm talking about? So I went out on had this long pier, and said, I'm going to go out there and get some white space. So I went out on this long pier, and I was out there, seagulls and smelling that good salt water. It was so wonderful. I was getting refreshed, and about this time, on this long pier, this guy comes walking out there. I said, oh my, if he stops, Lord, this is a long prayer. Let him keep on walking. Don't let him. Now, I know that's carnal, but I'm being honest. I said, but if he comes close, I'll talk to him. Well, sure enough, he stopped about far from here to right here. He stopped and he puts he does like this. He starts looking at the water just like I am. I noticed he had a University of Missouri football shirt on. So being a football fan, sports fan, I said, you played at the University of Missouri? He said, no, he said, I didn't. He said, I live up there. I'm a fan of Missouri. And we talked about sports and et cetera. Spiritual things came around. I said, so tell me about your spiritual background. He said, oh, I was a Catholic. I said, I don't believe in that anymore. I don't even ever go to Mass. I don't believe that. My sister's a nun, but I don't care anything about it anymore. I just don't go. Don't care. Don't believe in that stuff. I said, have you ever thought about Jesus and giving your life to Jesus? And so I shared the good news of Jesus, what he did for us. He listened intently. Then he asked me this question. He said, let me ask you a question, sir. He said, will Jesus forgive you of anything? I said, yes, he will. He said, anything? I said, anything. If you ask him, he said, then I'd like to ask Jesus to forgive me and save me. I said, you just pray this prayer with me. And so I said, just pray it out loud. I said, just keep looking out there to the water. Keep your eyes open and just pray this prayer with me. And I prayed a very simple prayer. Lord Jesus, He repeated after me, I'm a sinner. Thank you for dying on the cross for your blood. Thank you that you love me, and I ask you to forgive me, and would you save me? And I'll follow you the rest of my life the best I can. He repeated that word after word. We got through praying. His name was Tony. I said, Tony, did you ask Jesus in your heart? He said, yes, I did. I said, you know what that makes you? He says, a Christian? I said, it sure does. And I reached out, I said, let me welcome you. I'll be the first one to welcome you. I'm your brother in Christ. So we talked for a few minutes, and I had a tract in my pocket of four spiritual laws. So I pulled it out, and I said, now, I said, just here's my address and phone number. When you go back to Missouri, get in a church that preaches the Bible, be baptized, not to save you, but as a witness, and then start learning, growing Christ. He said, okay. So I gave it to him. We talked a little bit more, and he sauntered off. About 2 weeks later, the secretary comes to me, and she says, Pastor, there's somebody here to see you. I said, I don't have that on my calendar. She said, but you need to see this person. I said, what do you mean? She said, it's the FBI. I said, the FBI? She said, yeah. I said, okay, show him in. So he comes in, shows him his credentials, and I said, sit down, and we talked for a few minutes, and he pulled out that tract. He said, have you ever seen this before? Is that your handwriting? I looked at it. I said, yes, it is. He said, were you in Panama City? I said, yes, I was. I said, oh, my soul. We've been there on vacation with our kids, and I thought, my kids have done something. You know, why do you think it's your kids? I don't know. It just, my mind just, environmentalists, they pulled some seaweeds. I didn't know what happened. And so I was just sitting there kind of frozen. What's he going to say? And he said, you know this guy? And I said, well, I just met him. And I told him the story, what I just told you. He said, well, Pastor, he said, I want to tell you, I hope he meant what he said. Because he said, Tony is a murderer. He said, he abducted a woman in a mall, St. Louis, went across state lines. He murdered her. And we've been on his trail. We finally caught him. Now we're trying to retrace his steps and find out if there's anything else going on. And he's going to need all the help he can get because he's in bad, bad trouble. He's a bad man. So he left, and I thought, Tony came out there running from the law, a murderer, blood on his hands. And when he said, can God forgive me of anything? He was feeling the guilt of what he'd done. And God forgave him. Jesus did that for the thief on the cross. But you see, we're all like Tony. Without Jesus, we don't get there. We're not forgiven. We're guilty as charged. I'm going to see Tony in heaven someday because he trusted Jesus, just like the thief on the cross did. He was saved. If you've never been saved, the most important decision you'll ever make is to accept the grace and love of Jesus. He's superior in all his ways. Consider Jesus and the salvation that he brings. Consider the fact that he's put sin in subjection in our lives. Listen to what writer of Acts says, but thanks be to God that through what we used to be, slaves to sin, we have been set free from sin and become slaves not to sin, but to the freedom of God. He puts sin in subjection. That doesn't mean we don't sin after we get saved. We do sin. But we're no slaves. We're not addicted to it anymore. We're tempted, but we're not bound to it. We're not addicted to it. When we do wrong, we know to confess it, and we want to get right. We want the Father to be pleased with us and to forgive us our sins. And so he puts sin in subjection in our lives. So we're no longer slaves to sin. We're free from being addicted to that sin which captures and ruins so many lives. I had a soldier come to our house one night. His family said, would you talk to him? He's a captain in our military. Said he's got an alcohol problem. And he's desperate. He's afraid they're going to throw him out of the army. And his wife and children are desperate. Would you talk to him? And he came. He talked to us. A fine-looking, handsome young man. We talked for a while, and he told me. He said, I'm addicted to alcohol. He said, I can't overcome it. And I said, and we talked about Jesus and about his relationship with Jesus. He believed he was saved. But he said, I can't overcome this. I said, have you ever asked Jesus to help you overcome this? He said, I don't know. And I don't remember all the conversation, but I said, let's pray about it. So we got on our knees, I don't remember all that he prayed, but I remember one sentence that stuck in my mind I've never forgotten. He said, "Dear Lord, help me be the man you intended me to be." And when we trust Jesus, he helps us be the man or the woman that he intended us to be. That's who Jesus is. Consider Jesus. Consider him and the subjection of sin that he brings and the sense of significance that he provides for us. Look what we become. Paul said, "And you have become sons and daughters of God." You know, I'm not, my identity is not in my gender. I'm a male, and there's male and female. In the beginning, God created male and female. Now, there are some people today that think you can be this and that, and a part of this and a part of that, and a lot, all kinds of letters after their name. No. In the beginning, God made male and female. If Jesus tarries 5,000 years, when he comes back, it'll still be only male and female in God's sight. That's who God made us. He made us sons and daughters and adopted us into his family. Adoption is a wonderful thing. Some of you may be adopted. Some of you may have adopted children. What a wonderful thing. An adoption, in Roman law, an adopted son had more rights than a natural son did. So we've been adopted. When we're saved, we're in the family of God. And that brings us significance. So I'm not dependent upon my gender identity. I'm not dependent upon racial identity. There's so much of that trying to divide our country. You know, you've got white privilege and black privilege and brown and yellow and red. Hey, my identity is not because I'm white. My identity is in Jesus Christ. I am a Christ one. And that gives me balance. That helps me. I'm okay because I'm a son of God. I remember taking a taxi in Philadelphia one time, and this guy was driving around. He's saying, "Over here, this building over here," he's one of those guys, taxi guys that tells you about everything. And he said, "Over here is this, and over here is this building, and so-and-so built that." And about halfway through it, I said, "I'm going to try something." So I said, he said something about this building, this skyscraper. I said, "My father owns that." He said, "He does." And yeah. Drove a little further, and he says, "Here's this building over here, 40 stories high." I said, "Yeah, my father owns that too." So about the third time I said that, he turned around, and he said, "Who is your father?" I said, "Jesus Christ." He said, "Oh." Well, my father owns everything, ultimately. And I'm his son, adopted into the family of God. So that gives me perspective. It gives me a sense of significance. Sometimes, you know, we all of us have to fight inferiorities or things. We all come with baggage in our lives. Parents or whatever, you know, this happened. We all have baggage in our lives. Not anybody don't have baggage. But when I become a Christian, I'm a son or a daughter of God. Recently, a few years ago, we had a thrift shop at First Baptist, and we had things there for people to buy at a very small price or giveaways to help people. One of the guys that worked in it came in the office one day, and he said, "Brother Jim," he said, "I got some news for you." I said, "What?" He said, "They had a picture of you for sale over at the thrift shop." I said, "A picture of me for sale?" He said, "Yes, somebody had bought a picture of you, blew it up real big, and had it in a real nice frame, and they were selling it at the thrift shop." So I shouldn't have said this, but I said, "How much are they asking for it?" Shouldn't have, bad question. He said, "You don't want to hear this." I said, "Well, how much?" He said, "$0.50." I said, "$0.50?" He said, "That's not the good news." He said, "That's good news." He said, "The bad news is something else." I said, "Well, what do you mean?" He said, "They marked it down to 25 cents. Well, if I was, you know, nervous about who I am, that would really put a hurt on me. But I just laughed about it. Because my significance is not how much my picture is worth. My significance is who I am in Christ. And when you put your faith in Christ and become his son or daughter and begin to walk with him, he's the king and he's our father. He owns everything. And that's my father. That's my significance. Not in political identities, racial identities, sexual identity. My identity is in Jesus Christ. That's my identity. And that gives me focus in a crazy world. And last but not least, consider him. Consider the fact that his victory is yet to come. Victory at the cross, that's the ultimate, but there's one more. You know, we as Christians celebrate Lent, a time of Jesus when we give up something. Some of our religious persuasions give up this and give up that. Then we consider Good Friday when Jesus died on the cross, and we consider the resurrection when Jesus, you know, that's a lockdown the devil didn't win. He backed that lockdown down and rose up from the grave. Then he ascended into heaven. And the Bible says there's one more day. That's when the King is coming. And when the King is coming, then everything is going to be made right. It says he's coming, and when he comes, he has a name written on his thigh, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. His vesture is dipped in blood. He's riding a white horse, a symbol of military conquering. And he's coming to rule the world in righteousness and in truth. Our King is coming. Consider Jesus. This world will soon be under his leadership. No corruption, no bribes, nothing else, no big tech, farmer, business, politics, Our King will rule righteously, fairly, and our King is going to reign. It's going to be a fabulous world when King Jesus is enthroned, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Can't stop him. No, they can't, because he's coming. He's coming. He's going to make the world right. I heard a missionary tell about being in one of our countries and where the Muslim influence is very strong. He said he and his 10-year-old son were walking down the street one day, and suddenly coming down this narrow street, there's a funeral procession, and it was wall-to-wall people, and they were kind of running, carrying the casket over their head, and they were running down the street. He said, we were going the other way. We're afraid to get trampled. And he said, I was looking for what we could do, and he said there was a mosque there, right? And so I said, let's run in here. And so he said, I took my son. He'd never been in a mosque before. We took him inside the mosque, and he said, it was quiet, just as quiet in there. And he said, we just stood around. He was in awe. He looked around, huge mosque. He said, about that time, the imam came out, and in that native language, gave the words, Allah is God, and Muhammad is his prophet. And it echoed. Muhammad is his prophet, his prophet, his prophet, his prophet. And it got quiet. And before I could say anything, my son cupped his hand and he said, God is God and Jesus is his son. And he said, there it went. Jesus is his son. Jesus is his son. Jesus is his son. Jesus is his son. He said, Daddy, they can't stop him, can they? They can't stop him, can they? No. They can't stop him. Oh, they've tried to stop him. You try fire and he'll put it out. You try water, he'll walk on it. You try the wind, and he'll make it curl down at his feet and be quiet as a little puppy dog. You try the grave in a tomb, and he'll break it out and break the seal of any empire that tries to lock him up. You can't stop Jesus. So, my brothers and sisters, here's the word. In our day and our time, when it looks crazy, when we don't know what's happening, do what he said to the early church. Consider him. Look to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, so that you don't grow weary and give up. Don't do it. Remember who he is and who he has made you to be. And you can live a life of victory in a crazy world. And the people said, amen. Would you stand as we pray? Our heads are bowed and our eyes closed. I'm going to give the invitation, standing as an ambassador for Christ, for you to come and express your faith in Christ. Some of you today, maybe just where you're seated, you accepted Jesus. I want you to come and take Pastor by the hand and say, Pastor, I want to be like Tony. I want to be saved. I want to know I'm forgiven of my sins. Some of you have already done that, and you want to come and say, Pastor, I'm a Christian. I want to be baptized because Jesus told me to. You come. Some of you, the Lord's led to be a part of his church. Come from other churches and denominations. The main thing is you know Jesus, and you want to be a part of his family here at Mount Dora. You come. maybe just renew your vows to Jesus and say, Lord, I trust you. I'm looking to Jesus. Consider him. So, Father, I pray that in this moment of commitment, that you'll give faith to those who right now are saying, I need to go forward. I need to make this public. Give them courage to do it. And bless them as they come. And may your will be done in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing. Pastor will meet you. Aaron, you lead us, brother. You come.
Lord, I come. I confess. Bowing here, I find my rest. And without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are. And where you are, Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
Just bow your heads. Just pray just a little bit more. Anybody else? God speak into your heart. You come. While we pray, anybody else? Just come on. Just come on.
The Lord has been so very good to us for now weeks on weeks. Every week you're seeing something that many people do not get the privilege of seeing around our country. Every week the Spirit is moving so that people are drawn to Jesus Christ. The Lord Jesus said, no one can come unless the Father draws them. And so this is the work of God that you're seeing when people come forward. And so know this, an invitation is never closed. Many of you here, you know that things still aren't right between you and the Savior. And here's the good news. Jesus is not just in the invitation in the church. He's not just for Sundays. Jesus will go home with you, and he keeps knocking on the door of your heart wherever you are. Wherever you are. And he'll knock on the door of your heart on Monday and Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday and Friday and Saturday. He keeps knocking on the door of your heart. He's always there. Some of the greatest moments I've ever seen people have and ever known was when they were by themselves, whether it was on a pier or in a field or in their car, in their bedroom, even in their shower. Wherever you are, I want you to know Jesus
will go there with you. He's as near as a prayer if you're willing to call on him. When you call on him, he's right there. No invitation is ever closed. Know that the Lord Jesus loves you. He loves you, and he wants to walk with you through this crazy, upside-down world. He wants to be right there with you, carrying you when you can't walk. I look forward to seeing you Wednesday night. If you've never been on a Wednesday night, on this campus we'll have 200-plus people. There's Bible studies for every age group. The choir's meeting in here, and the youth over in the youth building. And we have Bible studies for men and women, and I have prayer meeting. Children fill the gym, and it's crazy, and it's a wonderful time. And so just know that there's a place for you here, because this is a wonderful place to call home. It really, really is. Let's close with a word of prayer. Now to him who is able to keep us from falling and to present us before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only wise God, our Savior, be all glory and power, majesty and authority through Jesus Christ our Lord, both now and forevermore. Amen and amen. Be blessed, church.
I was rich. I remember who I was. I was lost. I was blind. I was running out of time. Sin separated. The breach was far too wide. But from the far side of the chasm, you held me in your sight. So you made a way across the great divide. Left behind heaven's throne to build it here inside. And there at the cross,